Good afternoon, Biscuit Babies. It's me, William, the host of The Biscuit. We are here. Today's guest is freaking awesome. I'm very excited to talk to him before I unveil that, even though you already know because you clicked the episode to download it. I want to talk to you about hairless ape conspiracies. I wear hairless ape conspiracies. You should be wearing hairless ape conspiracies. They are the best shirt ever made. I'm not joking. I'm wearing one right now. The my new favorite one, the Assembly of Alpha shirt. It's a beautiful blue-gray kind of color. Fits nice. I'm a taller dude, you know, 6'4". It doesn't hang by my belly button. It's long enough for me. It's just so comfortable. It's veteran-owned, veteran-operated. Sam Burns, who you can go back and listen to on the podcast, is a brilliant man, a hardworking man, and I'm very fortunate to be partnered up with those guys. Have been a longtime sponsor of the show now, and I absolutely love those guys. Use the promo code BISCUIT10 at checkout. Save yourself 10% off. The website is hairlessapeinc.com. Go there, check it out. You will not be disappointed. Also, head over to parkersplatoon.org. See how you can help a veteran today. It's Scott Parker's nonprofit organization with his family to help one veteran at a time. They have pond hockey charity games, taco dinners, you know, poker rides in the summer. They get involved with veterans that are looking for companion pets. Just any way they can really help. You know, for instance, they had Cowboy Cerrone call my brother, who my brother is a United States Marine veteran of war. And just things like that to help guys out and let veterans know that they are appreciated. It's nice for those guys now, especially when everybody hates everybody, that, you know, they can get a little bit of love. And we are presented by HockeyFights.com. That's HockeyFights.com, where you go to watch hockey fights.
Now Probert got the right hand free. He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nylon, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt!
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's The Biscuit. It's The Biscuit.
Damn it! Set goal regulation size of one!
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. There's a country we'll stop working on so bad this fucking can.
Hi, everybody. It's The Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, you wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man. Good luck to you too, buddy.
All right, Biscuit Babies. Today I'm joined by the two-time Calder Cup champion, a husband, a father, a man with over 250 professional fights, and actually won 60% of them. That's pretty damn good if you look at the numbers. And a man of many flows and owner of Gratitude Fitness, Josh Gratton. How we doing, bud?
I'm doing good, man. How about yourself?
I'm doing real good, man. Was up this morning helping the brother do some drywall and just hanging out with the kids, having a good day, and now getting to talk to you, man. It doesn't get much better.
Good stuff. You made me feel a little bit pretty good about myself there with the intro. I appreciate that.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Dude, I follow your Instagram. I'm a big fan. Are you in the best shape you've ever been in?
Yeah, I'm very much taking better care of myself now than I did when I was playing a few years ago, that's for sure. Yeah, you have to keep up with these young guys nowadays.
Dude, it's impressive. I mean, you're jacked to the gills, dude.
Yeah, I take a lot of pride in my off-ice workouts and stuff like that. It's it's fun, I get a kick out of helping the other kids, the young guys, too. So, you know, it's I try to keep up with them, so it helps me try to keep up with them there.
Well, that's got to be good for them, too, you know, as a role model, you know, an older guy, you know, in the league, and them going, I mean, he's in better shape than me. I better pick it up. I'm only 22. So, I mean, that's probably good for them to be able to look ahead and see, you know, you got to stick with it if you want to play professional hockey.
Yeah, I think it just shows them if you got to take care of yourself. And I had guys when I was younger that I looked up to a lot. So you got to kind of show them the right way. They're going to do their own thing most of the time. But if they see someone in good shape and they see an older guy beating them in a couple of exercises or drills, then maybe it gives them a little kick in the ass to get them going a bit.
For sure, man. Have you always been a gym rat, or is that something new that you've added at the later years of your career here?
My first couple of years pro, not so much, but the last 10 years, yeah, I've always taken a lot of pride in it. But my first couple of years, I just went through the motions a bit with that. But back then, you didn't really have to be in great shape to. Now it's the game so fast that you have to keep up with everybody else. So
is that part of, opening up Gratitude Fitness and that kind of deal is, just your interest and, joy of spreading that information, just a better way that you can spread that information?
Yeah, it also holds me accountable, too. It gets me into the gym every morning, too. So you got to keep I got to keep in good shape to show the other guys and help the other guys. So it just became an interest that I followed through with, and I'm really enjoying it, and it's helping me. But I get a lot of satisfaction out of helping the other guys more than anything.
Now, I've noticed, in the latest or in the past few years, it seems that the trend is, functional lifting. Like, if you're playing hockey, you're going to be, working on, the muscles that are skating. It's not just guys getting in there deadlifting and squatting and getting out of the gym. It's more of a, what muscles am I using here? What can I actually use to function and get better at your said career, your said path?
Yeah, it's definitely more hockey specific. It's explosiveness and speed. It's the game so fast nowadays. You want to be as lean and as fast as you possibly can be nowadays. It's back when I started breaking in, guys would just get big and jacked, and it was all about strength, pure strength, raw strength. And now it's so fast that if you're not able to be explosive, you're not going to keep up or you're going to last very long in a league. Any league, that is. It's just it's a stepping stone from one league to the other. And I find that kids nowadays, and even when they're starting so young in juniors, that it's just going to be that much stronger and faster five years from now,
Oh, yeah. It went from, everybody looking up to Arnold Schwarzenegger to now it's like the CrossFit kind of – that kind of body and that kind of style of, lifting. Everyone's not in there trying to deadlift, 9,000 pounds.
No, not at all. I think a diet has a lot to do with it too. Kids nowadays don't really drink very often. When we broke into the league, when we were 16, 17, we were drinking all the time, and it's just that's how the game's evolved. And the off ice, on ice, So it's for the better. It's definitely better for kids to stay out of trouble and focus on their careers, because they start so young. All they think about is hockey nowadays.
Yeah, I think instead of you guys were hammering beers, they're hammering buttons playing Fortnite with each other at night instead of putting some units back.
Yeah, no doubt. We'd play video games at 5 in the morning when we'd be strolling in from the bar. Nowadays, they don't even go out to the bar.
So. Right, exactly, man. Well, that's perfect, man. Let's take a trip back to Brantford, where you were born. Is that what is Brantford like? And did you have a pretty strong hockey childhood there? Maybe some of your heroes and family members you played with?
Well, yeah, hockey was all over my family. My grandfather was a coach. My uncles both played professionally, both coached. And my cousin Chris played in the NHL. So it was all over hockey. And for myself, I didn't really care about hockey when I was younger. And I started from the lower, like junior B, junior D, and then when I was young. So I didn't really care too much. I was around it my whole life, so I kind of fell into it. So
when did you start to take it more seriously? Did a certain coach or somebody sit you down and go, Josh, you have a chance to make it to the show here?
I think it was probably – I was getting in a lot of trouble as a teenager, and there was a scout from St. Mary's Junior B, he just came in. He knew I could play hockey. He knew I was tough when I was 15 years old. And Brantford wasn't definitely the place that I was going to succeed or thrive in. And he got me out of there at 15 years old, which is really young for Junior B. And I owe a lot to him. His name was Angie Nigro. He's passed now, but he was one of the best scouts in junior hockey back in the day. And he pretty much gave me a chance and woke me up, got me out of some trouble back in Brantford, and got me out of town and started making me realize that I could probably be a hockey player if I wanted to put myself to it. So he's one guy that has definitely influenced my career at a young age.
Is Brantford, you know, a smaller city, or is it a town? What kind of...
Yeah. It's a shithole. It's a town with nothing going on, and besides a lot of good hockey players coming out of there, there's not much going on in Brantford.
So people kind of stick around there and start shit with people.
Yeah, just there's not a whole lot to do for young kids besides hockey. It's a lot of you get in a lot of trouble really really easy. It's a nice city. It's a clean city. It's a city. I guess that's any city. If kids don't have something to do or somewhere to go, then you're going to get in trouble. And that's kind of I shouldn't put it on the city. It was just more of the people I was hanging around with than anything.
Were you fighting back then, or were you still, you know, holding that to the ice, or was that kind of overflowing a little bit? And then that was
You know what? I've never really been in a fight off the ice. I was just
dumb
teenage,
shit.
Dumb teenage things. At a young age, it wasn't necessary to be doing.
Oh yeah, we've all done some dumb shit. That's for sure, man. I definitely hear you. Yeah. I'm lucky to missed a lot of trouble that I could have had. But you mentioned your cousin. Did he grow up in that area as well, Chris?
Yeah, he grew up in Brantford as well, and he got out of there at a young age too. So he was pretty straight arrow guy. He didn't really get mix it up with the wrong group or anything. So he's always had his head on straight, pretty focused athlete he has always been. So
I know he ended up retiring when he was with the Blue Jackets, where I'm from in Ohio. I know it was only like 6 or 7 games, but I always that's pretty cool for me, just to I remember that 6 or 7 games they did play.
Yeah, he had a great career.
He really did.
I think he played over 1,000 games. He was first rounder, made a lot of money, and he was professional about it. He played, I think he was one of the fastest to 1,000 games, so he really kept his head on straight. And that's as a professional athlete, to play 1,000 games in anything or play that lot, even working and doing the same industry for 10 years, you got to tip your hat to people. So I respect him a lot for how, and I looked up to him a lot too. So
It's remarkable. I mean, playing one NHL game is remarkable, and then you times that by 1,000. I mean, it's unheard of, really.
Yeah, it really is. It's such a impressive stat for the guys that get to 1,000 games. I don't even know. I've played 16 years, and I don't even think I've played 1,000 games pro. So those guys, they got to be such a perfect athlete, just take care of themselves. So I tip my hat to all those guys.
Absolutely. Sure. Absolutely. Now, you end up playing junior in the OHL, kind of the last Mohicans there, really, some of the last dudes there to be able to chuck them and really throw. I mean, now I think it's 3 fights and you're out of the league. And
yeah, that's fucking embarrassing, by the way. I think that's the biggest joke ever.
You go to junior and you get in 3 fights and you're done playing hockey.
Yeah, that's embarrassing.
That is embarrassing.
I don't know what they're trying to get out of that stat. The game has been around for how many years, and now they're pulling that shit. It's taken a lot of jobs away from kids that maybe want to battle and earn and have to go a backdoor route, so they don't have to just fight. There's lots of guys that just show a coach that they're willing to stick up for a teammate or go through a wall for a guy. Fights happen, and then 3 fights. I don't really understand what they're getting. I don't agree. I understand the head injuries or whatnot, but hockey and fighting has been around since day one. I don't know why they're trying to reinvent the wheel, you know?
I mean, I could see if you're a kid in that league and you get in three fights in a game. Okay, maybe we'll talk about that then. But three in a season is inhibiting these kids, and it's not putting asses in the seats either. And, you know, that's part of the deal as well. You know, I went to a Flint game, you know, a few months ago. It was Flint versus Windsor, who you played for the Spitfires there a little bit. And there's two big boys. I mean, I think the one kid is Curtis Douglas. He's like 6'8". And the kid from Flint, who just was traded, Gordiev, is like 6'5". And, you know, they're sitting there hitting each other with their sticks, is firing shit up. And, you know, Gordiev just wouldn't oblige him. The Douglas kid from Windsor, because he knows, he's like, I get one of these and I'm not getting scouted anymore. I'm kicked out of the league. I'm done. I lost my job. And the whole fucking crowd is going, you know, drop him. Let's see this shit. And it just never happens. It made it, and I don't want to say it made him look like a coward, but it just, I knew in his head he couldn't do anything, and it just sucked for everyone there and probably those two dudes on the ice too.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. There's so many different ways to look at it, but it's like when we were playing. I remember me and a good buddy of mine, Brandon Pruss, Cam Janssen. Like, we were having 30, 40 fights a year for our first 4 years in junior, and our first 4 or 5 years pro, we had probably close to 200 or 150 fights each. Like, it was pretty stupid, but and that's just the way, like, we were brought up. And I understand you don't need to be fighting that much, but three is absolutely crazy. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Some of the top players in the league fight three times in a year. You know, it doesn't make any sense.
Right. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. Maybe you needed to put some better rubber on it or something like that. But it went too extreme, in my opinion. But if there's sometimes where a fight needs to happen and it's a natural thing, and you got to let those go, I think. And you can't punish a kid if he has three of those. I mean, it's really it's unnecessary.
Yeah, I would understand three instigators or like three stuff that you're forcing someone to do something they don't want. But I get a fight with two guys with emotions wanting to fight. That's gonna happen. That happens anywhere. Happens at a bar. Happens at workplaces. It just happens. Like, it's you know.
Dude, it happens at 5-year-old girls' soccer games.
Yeah, testosterone. Yeah, exactly. It's too, and for guys like that aren't ever drafted or anything, they're trying to get noticed or they're trying to stick out, get the coach's attention. Like, we were fortunate enough, when we were breaking into the league, if you fought, you got noticed and respected right away. Like, it's tough to earn now. You can't even really hit and run around. Like, the stay-at-home defensemen were feared back in the day. There's always one or two a team, and now you don't even need a stay-at-home defenseman because no one runs you. There's barely any hitting in the game anymore, you know?
Yeah, the stay-at-home defenseman's, you know, like, it's like the enforcer. They're all but gone.
Yeah, that's the next thing. You're gone, and then it's just getting watered down into a soft hockey. But the skill is fun to watch. The speed is fun to watch. Yeah. But in my opinion, there's still always a place in the game for hard hits and a couple fights in the right situations. Emotional fights or like to get your team going. The stage fights, yeah, stupid. Like, there's some of the stuff that happens in that Quebec league. Like, that's a bit ridiculous, and it's more for show and entertainment. But the real emotional game and the real emotional part of the game of fighting and hitting, it's going to come back as soon as somebody, in my opinion, somebody hits the wrong guy. And another team's going to – Tom Wilson, for example, he's – prime commodity. Every team wants a Tom Wilson. They're going to be starting breeding them, and then it's going to come back. Every team will get a guy like Tom Wilson, and it's just going to get a spiral effect upwards, in my opinion. You know?
I agree with you, Josh. I think I agree 100%. I think they've tried to back it up so much that they realized it kind of went the wrong way, and I think even younger kids, I mean, there's a gap in there where – those kids don't want it, but there's kids growing up now that are going to want it back again, and it'll come back. It'll be cyclical. I agree with you.
When kids are 6'6", they're in the gyms getting training since they're 16, they're going to get fast, learn how to skate. Teams are going to build them and mold them just like Tom Wilson. They'll draft a kid like 6'5", that can skate in junior and that can hit and never has to worry about fighting. And then they're just going to – then they'll get it tougher and tougher. In my opinion, I think that's what's going to happen, you know?
Yeah, and, I you know, like the Quebec League, the LANHA, I never say it right, but, you know what you're getting when you go to a game there. That's, you know, expected. But I don't expect to see that in the NHL, and nor do I want to see that. I want to see hockey, but I want that element of the fight or the hit or the violence to be there, and if necessary, to let it happen.
Absolutely. Like, you could go through a game or – like the last couple of years, I went through games or watched games, or you don't even see a hit anymore. You could get like, guys will play till they're 50 because they don't get hit. There's no injuries, so they don't get hit anymore. Like, the physicality of the game and the emotion of the game. Sometimes watching the games on TV, it just puts you to sleep. You know.
No lie, there's times where I'll be up at night and I'm like, well, there's West Coast games going on. If I put one of them on, I'll, you know, fall asleep on the couch here, because it's just the sound of the skates, and you'll just fall asleep.
back in the day, you'd look at who's playing, and you'd be like, oh, there's a couple guys playing. There'll be some running around. There'll be some sparks flying. Like Ottawa, Toronto played the other night. It used to be like Battle Ontario. There'd be a couple fights, a couple big hits. I watched the game the other night. It was a dud, a sleeper. You know, the only good thing was listening to Bob Cole. But that's it, you know?
Yeah, dude. I think you're right. I think it will come back. At the beginning of this year, I predicted it was the leader will be under 10 fights, and it's looking to be about that way, which is just fucking crazy.
That's crazy. I remember some guys would have 10 fights in training camp back
yeah in trying to get that spot for sure, man. I remember Parks telling me a story. He fought, I forget the gentleman's name, but he fought him twice in one training camp in one like game. And he was like, because the other guy was trying to get it a look. And Parks was like,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
He's like, okay, I'll go you again, I guess. But it's like, holy shit, man.
You go to training camp, you'd know in August who you're fighting, because they'd have the training camp schedule out. You'd know who you're going to play, and then you know who you see. They sign, oh shit, they signed Morasti. Looks like I'm going him tonight, you know? Like,
yeah, yeah. that's a scary one to see too. Old,
yeah, yeah. never fun seeing that, or, you know, and he's coming in hungry. You have no choice in training camp either, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
So
and I think about that too, and looking at the names, and I've had a few guys on here, you know, Borshi and Daryl Bootlin and Cam Janssen, who have said, you know, have all brought up your name when they're going, you know, who was like one of the hardest guys to fight? Like, one of the hardest guys to punch ever is Josh Gratton, because he's like a cement head. He's like, did you ever see somebody hit you and then you knew, like, oh, he didn't know how hard it was going to be to punch me? Like, that's like a game changer when you break your hand on someone's face or like instantly. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't know. I was lucky to have a glass or a steel jaw like for a while. You know. And I just, that's just the way I always fought. It was more of a, just either I'm going down or you're going down. And luckily on most nights, I wasn't the one going down.
Those, I mean, that really is the style of your fight. It was kind of like that meet me in the center, here we go, let's see what happens. The one that comes to mind and is considered, you know, one of the best hockey fights of all time is you and McGratton going at it. And I don't know how either of you were standing at the end of that, man.
Oh fuck! That was a long one.
Holy shit!
Philly. Yeah, it was a good one. And he's the toughest that comes. And I was pretty much fighting to survive, and he was just fighting because it's just really like I was fighting to survive. He could kill me. The next time we fought in Binghamton, he fucking dusted me pretty good. But I stood in there with him every time, but never on the good end of it. He was always giving it to me pretty good. He's so strong and so big. There's pretty much grabs you and throws over you and then just puts you down. And luckily I stood in there, but he's the toughest to come, him and Colton Orr.
Yeah, dude. And I think that McGrann's got that X factor too, where he fucking loves it. Like he's like, you know, on Ice Guardians when he's going, oh no, I love this shit. Like this was like, I couldn't wait for somebody to run one of my teammates so I could go fucking fight somebody. And you're just like, oh man, you're a different level, dude.
He was a fucking man back then. But in juniors, he didn't really fight, and he didn't like fighting in junior. And then the couple years in pro, he was scary tough. Like, and it was crazy because in junior, he's a player. Like, he was good, but he didn't like to fight in junior. He did a fucking – but he could give it to anybody after junior. It was kind of weird.
I wonder if he got, like, a taste of the pros and was like, oh, I want to stay here. Or maybe it was just one fight, that was it, and it was like, okay, I'm going to just do this. I don't know, man.
He played with some tough guys too, to groom him a bit. I think he had like Dennis Bombe and them to,
that'll do
teach
it.
Teach him the ropes. So
that'll I think do that, it.
But fuck, he was scary tough. He was probably the best that I in my area. That's in my era, I would say him and Colton Orr for sure.
Yeah, I mean, even your fights with Bombe were fucking brutal as hell too.
Yeah, he was a warrior.
Dude.
I have all the utmost respect for him. He battled and did it for such a long time and never turned down fights, still protected his teammates at a late age. And as my age right now, I respect it, just knowing how hard it was on your body and your mind, and to still be a positive influence on your team that late into in your career. You definitely deserve the respect from all the guys you fought, but all the hockey players in the game that respect the job you do, you know.
And that was in the AHL when it was literally the jungle, when it was a fucking madhouse. You look at the guys that you were with fighting in there, and he's not turning guys down when he was, you know, one of the older guys. That's insane.
Yeah, guys nowadays have no fucking idea,
dude,
what it was like back then. It was. You go into a fucking into a barn, you know you're going at least once, and you're just hoping the guy's got a bad hand or he's getting scratched. But then that was a lockout year. There was no one called up, no one sent down, so you always knew what you were going into. It was fucking wild. To look back on it and to think back at that, all those players and all those tough guys. And you get out of there and survive a season. Like I think Janny maybe had 40 fights. I think I had fucking 30 something. Riley Cote had 30. Fedoric had a few. Ben Eager, that was our team. And then we would go into Wilkes-Barre. They'd have everybody. The only team that didn't have any toughness was Hershey. Besides Bowens Bombe, he was the only one there, so he would get sent to the wolves every fucking night.
And he, you know, he'd tend them too, man. That's a hats off to him.
He'd be like, "Gratz, I got a bad hand tonight. First shift." He's going, "Let's go."
What a fucking beauty, man.
Yeah, I respect him, man. I respect him. At that age, I was young and coming up, and I had really not really an idea who he was when I was coming up, but he let me know who he was really early.
And he held his own, too. I mean, he was no fucking punk, that's for sure, man.
Oh, he could fucking take a punch, too. He could take the punch better than pretty much most guys that ever did the role.
Dude, there's times when I look back at, like, those AHL teams around when, you know, when you're in the Phantoms or even in Cincinnati. Let me read a week to you of yours in Cincinnati, and this will fucking scare people. I mean, this isn't a season. This is fucking 1 week in February you had with Cincinnati, dude. You got Mike Scroy, then Jimmy Roy, then Ivanis, and Rocky Thompson, which is one of your best fights for damn sure. That fight's fucking a beauty. Les Borsheim, and then round the week off, you know, with Pete Vandermeer. It's just like that's fucking crazy, dude.
That was 1 week.
That's one fucking week, dude.
Yeah, that would be considered nowadays young and dumb. young, dumb, and hungry. You know what? I think that week was probably the week that made me stay there because Philadelphia played. We played Philadelphia after that, and then I had those two fights to end a week that I didn't have a clue. That was 1 week, but I had those two fights, and then I signed with Philly the next year. So maybe. maybe it was what put me on the radar. But
I was looking at the names. I was like, holy shit, that's a list of dudes in a row. And I was like, oh, that's like 8-9 days there. That's fucking that's crazy.
I just got called up. I think to Cincinnati because I was in the coast grinding it out there, fighting everyone down there, and I got called up there. So that was a long season. Now that I look back at it,
but dude, and
that's one hell of a week to survive that one.
And Evanos's fights with you, those were some fucking battles too. He's a whole lot of big fucking Latvian.
Yeah, I used to call him Ivan Drago. Fuck, he's
for
huge.
Sure, for sure, dude. He's fucking huge.
He tagged me a couple times in the American League. I hung in there when I was in the NHL with him, but in the American League, he was big, and I was still a kid coming out of junior, but I was just open fighter. And sometimes those big guys would catch you, and it'd bring you back to reality, and you realize you're fighting men, not boys, you know.
Oh yeah, I mean, what, you're 6'2", 6'3", 230 pounds, or 216, or whatever it is. I mean, you're not a small dude, and you get up to him, you're like, oh, that's a fucking man mountain, dude.
Yeah, he was huge back then. I don't think I've ever seen a guy that big in outside of junior, besides my first year. He was playing in Milwaukee, if I remember right.
Yeah, I think so.
But yeah, he was a tank.
Yeah,
Scroy was tough back then, and they were all hungry too. They were just like me, hungry. You're just trying to make a name for yourself back then.
Now, see, I wasn't too familiar with Scroy until as of late. Borshi turned him on to me because he was talking about some of the guys he used to fight. He's like, there's no one fucking tougher than Scroy at the time, man. He was one of them dudes, you know. It wasn't out to play a whole bunch of hockey, but I mean, you know what I mean. He fucking loved to fight.
He was those guys that you just hated to fight because doesn't know there's a puck on the ice, but just wants to fight and makes you have to fight him. Like, he's screaming at the bench and everything.
Exactly.
And he's like, and you have nothing to gain by fighting him, but you have to do it. And that's how he stayed in the leagues he did so long, is because he made a scene, and he was tough, but he didn't know there was a puck out there most nights.
Yeah, but he would make it, because he'd go over to your teammates and yell at the whole fucking bench, and he'd be like, oh, now I gotta go, this guy.
Exactly. So he knew how to play the role, and he did it right. I respect the guys that try to play hockey and run around and hit and force you to fight that way. Like, I never really respected the fight the way he did, the way Scroy fought, did all that stuff.
Personally. Yeah, you probably should know that you're playing hockey. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, Cam Janssen was the best at it. He would run around and he would crush guys and force you to fight. He wasn't the greatest player with the puck or making plays, but he got better every year. And he made a player. Like, I always thought, like, a guy like Morass, your Scroy, or just instead of taking a summer in the boxing ring or UFC ring, go on the ice and work on your skating and skills. And,
yeah,
you know, like, Jody Shelley was the same way, and he got better every year. Like, worked on your game. It's either you want to be a fighter or you want to be a hockey player. Like, pick one.
Yeah, dude, Jody's a fucking hero of mine, man. That guy,
he was scary tough, too. I was glad I never had to fight him, but he fought everybody. He would have him lead the league in majors every year, pretty much.
Dude, he's got one of them fucking – it just looks like his head hurts to punch. You're just like, dude, I don't even know. Like, God, dude.
Yeah, he could take a punch in hand. He knew how to fight, and he was open, but he could fight technical too. He was one of the best at it too.
Well, that was one thing that Cam and I talked about, was him constantly working on his game. Like, he wasn't, like you said, taking boxing in the summer. He was, you know, going back and taking skating with, you know, even if it was 14-year-olds, he was out there doing it.
Yeah, his first couple of years pro, he couldn't fucking skate, and he turned into being a regular third, fourth line player in the NHL. Like,
that's a long time.
Determination. That's not just from fighting. That's using fighting to get yourself to the league, and then working on your game to stay there. You know.
Yeah.
And that's what I always tried to do as well. Like, I respected that. And I used fighting as a tool to get noticed. But at the end of the day, you want to be a hockey player, and you're there to help your teammates. And those are the guys that are still in the league or that lasted so long. Like, he played a long career for a guy that I don't even know if he was drafted. I think he was free agent to Syracuse, and then they signed in Columbus.
Yeah, and it's like you said, that is using a tool to get to where you want to be, and then bettering yourself every year. Because like you said, it wasn't just by chance that he got better at ice skating. He worked his fucking dick off at it.
Yeah. Yeah, and he wanted to be a hockey player. He didn't want to fight. He fought because that's what got him there, and he never forgot what got him there. But he played himself into getting a couple year good contracts, fucking regular shifts on some good teams. Like that says a lot about his character and his perseverance, you know.
Now, and I know you said earlier, you know, that people knew when you were on the ice you're going to fight too. But I mean, putting like 40 plus points up in juniors. You can play some goddamn hockey. It always blows my mind that people are just like, blah, 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 fucking goon. Like, no, I'm learning something, doing something, and applying it to how I can help said team. And I can stay in the fucking NHL. Like, it's using your noggin, really.
Yeah, you got to be able to play. No one likes one-dimensional players, and those are kind of the guys that have made fighting get taken out of the game in a sense, because there's lots of guys that could play. Todd Fedor could play regular shift. I've always learned, and I always had coaches that worked on my game with me and worked on my skating every summer. I'd be in the gym working on my skating, stick handling, just everything. And then the guys that never did it, they never got games. And that's it just never made any sense to me personally. I just like, why would these guys want to just go in the gym, fucking throw up some weights and hit a heavy bag when they could go on the ice and try to get a chance? Like, Morasti was as tough as they come.
Yeah.
Would have got a game if he could just skate or play a little bit. Like,
oh, he definitely, you know? I mean, he was so close to getting that too. If it would have, like you said, even a couple of summers just in there, I think he would have got it.
Just worked on a game. Just show people that you're not just a meathead, you know. Like, I'm not saying he's a meathead. I'm just using that reference, like terminology. It's just like you got to be able to play. Like that's, you're labeled as a one-dimensional player, then you're labeled as, you're not going to help the team. You know.
Well, there's a plateau for that type of player, and it was, you know, get a couple games in the AHL if you were lucky at that point. I mean, you're not going to be able to even have the opportunity like yourself to, you know, lead the NHL in pins 1 year, like in 2006. To have that opportunity, you have to be able to skate, to play hockey, to have knowledge of the game. But you also have to know, this is what I'm best at here in the NHL. This is what I'm here for. This is, you know, obviously I can play fucking hockey, I'm in the NHL, but I mean, I'm getting a chance to be here to do a certain thing. You know, if I can throw in some points in there too, you know, God willing, but I also don't want to get sent down because there's a dude waiting that'll do this.
Yeah, that's it. You use what you get you there, and then you get a little more rope, and they give you a little more rope, a little more ice time, and maybe you get put on the penalty kill like Brandon Prust, like John Tortorella played him. Prusty was his first couple years in the NHL. He was fighting all the time, and then he started getting a regular shift a little more, and then Tortorella put him on the penalty kill, and Prusty showed that he could penalty kill, and then he itched himself out a career signing in Montreal for a big deal. So like, just guys that come up and use it to get into the league, break themselves into the league with you making a name for themselves, and then you get a little more rope, and you know, it's a hard thing to do, but that's what you got to do to stay there. You can't just be one dimensional, and the guys that get up there and do it for a bit, it's tough. The hardest thing to do, it's not get to the NHL, it's to stay there. So.
Right, right. And I think that's a thing, and I like a coach like that John Tortorella. I know he gets shit on a lot, and, you know, I was listening to something with Avery shitting on him the other day, but it's like, he says it straight up. If you're going to work hard, I'm going to put in a guy that works hard out there before somebody who should, you know, because of his name, just deserve it. And it's just the truth. I mean, in Columbus here now, he'll scratch guys that you would go, well, what the hell? It's because they're pissing him off. They're not working hard. They're not playing both ways. And he doesn't give a shit. Like, it doesn't bother him to scratch somebody. And I always appreciate about them. And like the Prust story, I mean, that's amazing. A dude who made his way fighting, but, you know, got a cut in the penalty kill. Maybe it wasn't working so well. He got out there, worked his ass off, and stayed on it.
Yeah, and that's just like you said, that's Tortorella as a person. He respects hard workers, like you said, and Presti was one of the hardest working players, never drafted the OHL, never drafted the NHL like myself. So, like, for him to get an opportunity, and the reason that Tortorella would respect him so much is because he knows that Presti would do anything. He'd put his body on the line to protect his teammates, to get the team going, and Torts, he loves that kind of game, and all the old school coaches, they respect that because they know, like, what it takes, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And for him to give an opportunity to Presti, like, Presti could always play hockey, but a lot of guys could have been in the same boat that could always play, just never got a chance, you know? And he's lucky enough that he had a coach to give him that leeway to prove that he could penalty kill it, prove that he was a good enough skater to play in the NHL. Like, he really carved out a great career for himself, but a lot of people don't get that opportunity with some of the coaches there. And if it's not the coaches, it's not just the coaches, there's so many variables to sticking in the NHL. Is injuries, could be some guy coming back, could somebody guy be out long term, you know? So there's so many, it's like right place, right time, you could say, but it's also you make your own luck and you buy by hard work.
For sure. And I mean, even after the head coach or general managers, maybe he doesn't like you, the coach loves you, you know, it's not going to matter what the coach wants at that point.
Yeah. Maybe there's a first round pick coming up. Maybe there's so many variables that it's sometimes unfair, and you know what? Life's unfair. So
yeah.
You got to make your own breaks in life.
It's at the end of the day, and you know, this has been something that's been brought up on the Biscuit before. It is a business, and it is, you know, there's guys up top that aren't looking at the name Josh Gratton. They're going, you know, here's 0002. Let's get in 0003. But, you know, they're just moving pieces on a fucking computer. You know, that's all it is to them.
Yeah, a lot of times you're just a piece of meat to fill in, or analytics nowadays is taking a big role and taking a lot of people out of the game. At the end of the day, you still got to play a fucking game, you know, and you still got to have emotion. You still have to. There's things that you're never going to take away from it that analytics can't make up for, you know.
Are you boys, like, when you're, you know, younger and you're getting ready to, you know, start breaking in the league, and you know whether it be AHL, NHL, are you aware of where you end up going, and say there's a head coach, you're going, oh shit, he doesn't like an enforcer, or, you know, why couldn't I have gone here? Are you, do you feel, you know, fortunate, like, you're, oh, like, thank God I'm going to Philly, like, they'll let me fucking play the way I can play?
Yeah, there's a lot of times, or even like in a season, a coaching change that comes in and it benefits a guy or hurts a guy. Like, you always want to sign with a team or with a coach that you know that's had that type of team or likes that type of player. You always look at it, but there's some teams back in the day when I was playing, like, you'd love to play John Stevens, Craig Berube, and Paul Holmgren. Those three were the ones that molded me as a professional in my early years of being a pro, and they taught me the ropes, gave me opportunity, and that's just because they respected the roles so much. And Philly's the best place for a player like myself, Ben Eager, Riley Cote, just because those guys, they already been through it. They're old school. They went through hell and back, and they're still surviving. And you learn a lot every day, seeing those guys every day and hearing their old stories. Like Craig Berube, I have him and John Stevens as coaches. I have so much respect for them. As a young guy, they took care of me and played me every night just because they knew it. They knew the role. There'd be some days that I'd be grumpy as fuck coming into the rink, and they would say something, laugh, or tell a joke, and just because they know how hard it is. So if you have a coach that's played that role, it's just like, I guess, if you have a coach that's a goal scorer, knows how to get a goal scorer going, or can relate to a goal scorer. So it definitely helps, that's for sure.
Oh man, when you get Berube as a coach, you gotta be going, fuck yes, like, thank God that dude's like, he's what, over 2,000 some fucking PIMs in his career. He's just like, that guy, he's the best.
Yeah, he was a legend, and we played against him. I had played against him the year before. He was playing for the Phantoms the year before my year in Philly, so I was terrified of him, and then I ended up fighting Pete Vandermeer that day, that game. So I didn't have to fight the big chief. And then the next year, he was the assistant coach, and he taught me so much. And I'm so glad he's doing good now in St. Louis. He's turning that ship around. I hope they make the playoffs.
Dude, I hope so too. I wish him the best of luck. I would love to see, you know, him take that team, and because, fuck, they're surrounded with talent, but sometimes you just need a dude like that to get in there and put the pieces in the right parts. And and if they like playing for him, they're going to play better, too. That's a real fucking thing.
And a lot of guys playing for a coach that's been through 1,000 fucking games, like in the NHL, a couple thousand penalty minutes, like they're not talking back to him. They respect him, and they respect everything he does. And you know what? And his hockey mind is unbelievable. He's very, very, he sees it and teaches the game so much. Like, you wouldn't understand how much I learned from him as a player. And he's just a teacher, and maybe it's because he's watched so many games from the bench or sitting on the fourth line like I used to do. You know, you see the game and you respect the players a little more knowing the role you played.
Yeah, there's
– never had anything handed to you, so you got to work for everything in that kind of role.
Yeah, I keep a handful of cards, hockey cards, in the studio out here, and he's one of them that never leaves the rotation looking at me. So I always got him, Wendell, and Bob Probert.
Does he have the fucking mullet going?
Oh yeah, buddy, on the back he sure does. That fucking sick black. Dude, he's a good looking dude too.
A big chief, that's it.
Yeah, buddy. Well, you had some pretty decent flows going on back in the day, too.
Yeah, hockey hair, I can't grow it anymore. I'm too old. But, no, everyone had long hair back in the day. I remember one fight, fucking me and George Peros both had long hair, and he pulled my hair out, and the fucking guy, and it was in Manchester. He was pulling my hair. I was losing it as he was beating the shit out of me.
That'll it'll make you a different kind of mad. I had long hair for like a decade, and it when someone pulls your hair, just like, oh my god, you motherfucker! Yeah, like,
I don't know if there's anything more painful than getting your hair pulled out, to be honest.
Oh, it's the fucking worst. It'll drive you crazy, man. Now I know the level of competition is going to, you know, get higher and higher. Like, you know, from the OHL to the East Coast League to the AHL to the NHL. Is that the same way with fighting too, or is it? Is it more level all the way down through with fighting? It seems to me, at least, but I've never really asked anybody before. I just started getting really curious about that.
You know, there's tough guys everywhere. I always went into a fight not thinking about the person, because at any given time you get caught with a punch.
So right.
The levels of fighting and technical or experience, of course, is pros. The older in the NHL, those guys have been around and went through the minors, and they did it. In the minors, you're fighting 30 times a year. I think it's not level of toughness or it's more experience.
Yeah,
it is a difference, because in the NHL, you're not fighting 30 times a year. You're fighting guys that have already fought 30 times a year and have been through it. So I think that's probably the best way to compare it is the experience level is, because in the American League, East Coast, even junior, there's always tough guys. There's always someone tougher, and someone can always get caught with a lucky punch. Someone could always buckle you. There's not one tough guy. One guy's tougher than the others. There's guys that like it more. There's guys that can take a punch better, but I think it's probably just the experience is the biggest factor as you grow up. Because for me, I never changed the way I fought, and I still don't to this day. And it's probably going to catch up to me down the road. But like, it's just the way I've always went about my way. I never went in and like looking forward to a fight. I went in. Knowing I'm going to war, and if it happens, it happens. You know.
Well, you just fought a tough SOB a couple weeks ago, didn't you?
Garrett Hunt? Yeah.
Holy shit!
Yeah,
he's been around.
Yeah, there's still doing it. It's definitely weeding his way out. Like this game, it's more of a skilled game now. But there's still fights, and there's still really tough kids coming up, and there's still tough kids in the American League, and there's. The NHL, there's still tough kids there, but those kids are all can play, and it's not the first priority in their minds. So, like, there's some undercover tough guys that you wouldn't even know anymore if they're tough or not, because they're not fighting 30 times a year; they're fighting two or three. So, you know, right. You don't know how tough a guy actually is.
Well, that's I had Luke Gazdick on a couple weeks ago, and he was kind of saying that same thing. He's like, I don't have to show my right hand anymore. He's like, I'm sure, you know, I hope the kids are aware of him, but I mean, if there's one that isn't, I mean, he could really drop one on somebody that didn't know any better.
Yeah, and it's not even so much everybody would know who he is. It's him fighting the other guys, not knowing the other guys. Because back in the day, you always knew who a tough guy was coming up. Like, they would have already had 10 fights in the East Coast as they're going up to the American League. So for him, it's probably tougher for him not knowing than, because everybody knows who he is already. Yeah, it's probably tougher for him to not know his opponent as well as he could, you know. And he's tough. I had a couple good fights with him in the American League, and he throws hard and heavy.
Yeah, he sure does. Well, that makes sense, man. Like, even like that, even that Windsor game I went to, that kid who can't fight three times in a year might be a monster. So someone might start some shit with him if he goes up.
Yeah, that's the thing. You don't know your opponent nearly as well as you used to. You used to hear war stories of a guy coming up, you're like, watch out for this guy, you know.
Yeah,
now I have no idea.
I wanted to ask you about your magic elbow pad. It always seemed to just kind of fly off. Was that before they started regulating the gear, or did you have a special name brand Josh Gratton one that just flew off? Maybe it was a size too big or something.
I always kept it loose, and I always had my jerseys always were a little bigger on the sleeves. I didn't like having my elbow pad getting tied up, and if I could get it off. It's kind of just a little trick. So yeah, some guys have a couple other things that they keep loose, or, you know, I was lucky enough that it would come off quick. It was I don't know if many guys knew, but it would come off. It was just really loose. Sometimes if I knew I was going to fight, I'd leave it on the bench. If I was going to fight for a shift. So.
It did. I don't think a lot of guys notice it, because it would fly off, you know, in your first, like, you'd throw your arm down and it kind of fly off. I'm like, oh, there it goes. It's game time, dude.
Yeah. So that, and I used to wear big jerseys because I was kind of a smaller guy. I didn't have, and guys would pull your jersey, and then you just get a little loose, and it'd be tougher for them to get a grip on you. Just little things like that back in the day. But nowadays, the jerseys are so tight that it doesn't work like that.
Right. Yeah, you couldn't get that thing off if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
So you end up signing with Atlanta, and they send you to the KHL. What is it like playing in Russia? Because they're not really fond of the way, you know, some of the guys that ended up going over there play. At least to my knowledge, I don't know a lot about the KHL, but I know Morasti was over there when you were there as well. Were you guys hindered in your playing style, or was it, you know, such a huge barrier in language that it didn't – it was just like, what the hell are we doing here?
No, I went over there. I got to play. Like, I went over to play and fight a little bit, but you know, for me it was good. It helped me work on my game, work on my skating, and it's probably – one of the better things I did is went over a little earlier, made a little more money than I would have, and I got to play the game, and less physical on my body. Like,
yeah,
those guys, Morasti and Yablonski, came over there, and they kind of ruined it, because the league was starting to get guys like myself, like Darcy Bureau, that could play a little bit. Like Lacouture went over there for a bit. Like, every team was starting to get a guy that could play and run around a bit. And then those guys came over, and all they did is fight and cause brawls and suspensions. So they kind of put I ended up playing 3 more years after that, but they kind of put a damper on everything and cooled every team off of getting the guys. So those guys came over and were getting like 10, 15 game suspensions. It was pretty ridiculous. The team they had, him, Kip Brennan,
oh,
Chris
shit.
Simon, like, it was dumb.
That was all in one team.
The coach was Andre Nazarov. So, like, they just had a bunch of meat running around and scaring the Russians.
Simon, Brennan, and Morasti were all on one team.
And Yablonski.
Holy fuck!
Yeah, it was stupid. Like, and they, a couple of them would get a 5-game suspension, then they'd have another guy. It was dumb. But then you'd go there, and only other teams had a couple other teams had one or two tough guys. So it was them bullying everybody, and they kind of put a damper on the idea of other teams getting anyone. So now, it didn't work out.
I read online that you got a 15-game suspension over there from a brawl, but I can't find the brawl. I found like a fight from that game, but I don't know if that's even true or what the hell happened there.
I got 15 games there. So our boss was a mafia guy.
And, holy shit.
the year before, he had a beef with the other team, and so he wanted our team to start a brawl right off the draw, and he said, if you guys don't do it, don't bother coming back, and you're not getting paid. So me and Darcy Rowe had no choice. We just started a brawl. I ended up just getting in a fight, but they cracked down and just roasted us with a pretty shitty suspension. And the worst part was there was only 16 games left in the season, so I had to get bag skated for 15 just to collect my money. But, you know, ever since then, I've played the game pretty honest. Nothing worse than being suspended for something so stupid. And it was just dumb. It was really dumb.
Well, you stayed overseas for a while after you ended up going there, right? Just to come home just recently, right?
Yeah, I was over there for about eight years after I left it, pretty much. Back and forth. I came back to play in Manchester when we won the Calder Cup.
Nice.
I came back after that year, but I've been back over there. I enjoyed my time over there. It's a different game. It's more of a skill and speed and skating. So you got to develop it and work on your game. And it's helped me prolong my career by at least a few years for sure.
Do you like that bigger ice?
Not really.
That's a lot of skating, dude.
it is a lot of skating, but it's less work on your body. You're not hitting as much. You're not getting hit as much. So it's a little more time and less games. You play less games over there too. So it's a different world, different hockey and different lifestyle. But the experience is you can't explain the experience you get. And I would recommend any guy eventually in their career to at least go test it out once over there. Just for the life experience.
I think if you had the opportunity to and you turned it down to stay and play in fucking Kingston or something, I think you're messing up. I don't see what you would gain from staying in Canada from another year. If you're still going to be playing at that level, you might as well, like you said, go to Russia for a year and check it out. Maybe make some more money.
Exactly. You learn and you meet some people, you meet some friends. It's life experience more than anything.
Get some stamps on the passport. Why not?
That's it. Yeah, that's it.
What's something fucking like really weird and European you saw? Like, did you go to like a gas station? There's like a techno party in there or something like that. Or...
Casinos in the gas station.
Oh hell yeah.
Fuck, there's so much. There's so many different things. I can't think of anything off the top of my head. It's just
a different place.
Yeah, like people are just soldiers walking around with guns, normal. Like it's just and stuff that you until you see with your own eyes, you can't experience. Like in Russia, the toilets are just holes in the ground. Like you just take a shit in the hole in a hole in the ground. Like, it's just stuff like that is fucked up. But it's until you see it with your own eyes, it doesn't do justice the stories. You know,
shit. I've done that in Michigan a couple times. I don't think I was supposed to though.
No. Yeah. So.
Now, when you guys are, you know, in a tilt, and I've noticed in a handful of years, there's, I think in particular, the Barnaby fight, he's talking to the refs quite a bit. Is that frequent? Are you guys talking to the refs a lot, and are they listening? And, like, what is that exchange like? Are you guys saying, you know, get the fuck away, let us go, or can you call in to stop the fight? I've always wondered, because they're right there, I always wondered what that exchange is like.
Depends. A lot of times you're saying back off because you got a little edge on the guy and they're gonna break in. They're gonna come in. Janssen was best at it. He always tell him to hold off because he wanted to go longer.
His were like 4 minutes.
Not many people are asking the refs to come in, but they're probably hoping the refs are coming in. But usually, if the guys are talking, they're telling the refs to stay out because they're about to get going or wind up here.
That was the thing about Jansen's fights. Holy shit, dude! It was gonna be a five round round fight or 5 minute fight.
Marathons. He had the stamina. It was one of the best. He could go along with some of the longest fights you'll see.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Just a few more for you, if that's all right, Josh.
Yeah. No problem.
Man. Cool, man. What do you think, you know, you look back and you've won two Calder Cups, you know, one in Manchester, one in Philadelphia there. You know, you led the NHL in PIMS one season. You know, you just talked about being in the KHL. What was – can you pinpoint maybe the most favorite time of your career? I mean, maybe it's even now being in South Carolina playing. What was your favorite time of your career? I mean, not that it's over. I know you're still playing, but are you able to look at that
right now? I'm having some of the funnest time I've had in a long time. I'm enjoying myself now, but like first NHL game, there's so many more, but I got to say my first Calder Cup is first taste of winning the championship. I've had special bonds with those guys for the rest of my life.
Dude, and
some of my best
hard.
Friends to this day. And I just the first taste of winning, you know, you say it all the time, everybody wants to win, but until you actually win and get a taste of it, like, you know, it's an experience that you'll never forget the rest of your life. And I was fortunate enough to do it twice, and there's not one that's better than the other. Just that one was probably the first time, and I realized why you play the game, and you finally get satisfaction out of all the hard work. And before that, I just played the game. I never really won anything before that, so Just, I'd have to say probably my first Calder Cup. The experience was unbelievable, playing in front of 10,000 at home to win it at home there, and the fun we had after, it was just crazy. You know? If I could tell stories, I would about that. But we're gonna keep some of those. We're gonna keep some of those quiet.
maybe for a later day.
yeah. No, that's got to be the highlight of the one of the biggest highlights, and gratification of satisfaction of winning for the first time. I'd say that's probably the highlight of my career.
Yeah, I know it's kind of a weird question since you're still playing, but I just, you know, wanted to get a gauge on that. And that Phantoms team, I mean, there's just some fucking beauties on that team. And when you talk about that too, like, it's not like you guys, I mean, winning a beer league is fucking awesome, but you guys won the second best cup you can get in the world.
Well, at that year, there was a lockout year too, so there was
that's
no one NHL. So it was the top of the top of the top, and the American League will never be that good again. So, like, and to win it in Philly, the fans are unbelievable. To play in front of them, and they respect the grinding game so much. We had four heavyweights on our team. We had skill. We had first rounder Jeff Carter, Mike Richards, Patrick Sharp. Fuck, with Dennis Seidenberg, well, you name them. There's been NHL stars from that team. Like, it was just unbelievable, and all the whole league was unbelievable at that year to win that, and the way we did it, it was so hard to explain in words the feeling you get from it. You know?
Yeah, man, it's absolutely amazing, and to be able to do it twice, dude, that's really incredible, man. You're definitely well deserving of that. This is a question I don't usually ask, and it's whatever reason I find it. I don't know. I'm going to ask you just because I want to know personally.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite fight of yours?
A favorite fight? I think the one with Colton Orr was probably one of the better ones. It was in playoffs. That was the year we won the Calder Cup too, and he was a tank running through the league that year, and we had a good one. It was went over a minute, and I went into the dressing room, and I went right to the toilet and started throwing up. I was so out of breath, puking, and just the guys came in, and just they're so pumped up. That was probably one of the best ones in the American League, and you know that or the McGrattan one is probably one of the best ones too. And then I've been on the wrong end of a couple fights that I won't forget as well. So, but those ones are good ones because they're both. Both guys got out of there safe, and there's no bad blood. You know, there were two good tilts with two tough guys that everyone got out of there safe, and there's no bad blood. And it was for the right reasons. So probably those two.
I think that's why the McGrattan fight is, you know, considered one of the best hockey fights of all time, because it's just bombs, 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 and both guys, you know, skate away.
Yeah, and that was our roles. We knew our roles at that time, and we were doing it for the right reasons. And it's always nice that no one got really hurt, but fans liked it, and we both showed up, and he showed me he was number one, and I hung in there. So
and it's, you know, there was no weird thing at the either. Like, no matter if you guys respect each other or not, which you obviously do. You both just skate away from each other because you just were in a fucking fist fight. It was like, okay, you know, get away from me. It wasn't sometimes the bro taps can be a little weird at the end. I've never, you know, fought on the ice like that, so I don't know how it really works. But I always like them when they end that way instead of the, you know, thanks for the opportunity butt slaps.
Yeah. No, I think we're probably too tired to even talk or do anything.
That's probably right, bud. That's probably right.
Yeah, no, if you're in a fight like that, you get automatic respect for your opponent and you get respect back. You don't need to be tapping and saying thanks, you know?
Oh, shit, man. Now, so you're down in South Carolina now playing with the Stingrays?
Yeah. So we're just, I was over in England this year and kind of hated it. So I came back here one last year here, maybe one more next year. I'm not sure yet.
Let's do one more.
Yeah, well, you never know. I've said that for 5 years now. So I'm having a great time here. It's a young team. The coaches is awesome, and the city's great. Fans are great. And, you know, these young guys are keeping me young. I'm having a lot of fun. There are a lot of laughs every day. So it's been a good time so far, and hopefully we can finish it here maybe this year or maybe next year, but with one more championship just to go out if I'm still playing, want to win, you know.
What city is it in South Carolina?
Charleston. What a city.
Nice. Hell yeah, man. Yeah,
it's one of the nice cities I've been around. It's I'm surprised this team, like everybody that I've ever talked to has said nothing but good things. So I came here not knowing what I was getting myself into, but it's been more than better than I thought it was going to be.
Now, how did you end up there from, I think Scotland or wherever you were?
Yeah. The coach just reached out to me when I was going to shut it down, and he reached out to me, said they'd like to see if I wanted to come here. And nice. I was like, well, you know what? I've been still in good shape. Want to play a little longer. And, I said, fuck it. I'll give her a whirl. And, so I'm so glad I did, cause I'm having a blast.
I'm glad you did too, man. It's good to have you back here playing. You know, I'm in the States, so I'm a big fan of it. And, it's like you said, if you don't get the cup this year, I say you give it one more year. We try to make a run at it next year, win that fucking title, and call it a day, man. You've had a hell of a fucking career, man.
I appreciate that, and it's that's a plan as of right now. Hopefully, we get it done this year. That's why we're playing right now. So.
Fucking hey, Tom Brady it out, dude.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, Josh, dude, I really appreciate your time, man. I'm a big fucking fan. This is a real treat for me. And just tell the listeners where they can find you. I know you're on Instagram and all that good shit.
Yeah, Gratty24 is my handle on both Instagram and Twitter, so you can catch me on there. I'm not too much on Twitter, I just but Instagram here and there. So I appreciate all the support, and thanks for having me on. It's been a blast.
Absolutely, yeah. If you fat slobs want to get some fucking motivation, get on his Instagram and look at how shitty you are.
That's it.
Dude, thank you so much, man. I appreciate you, bud.
All right, man. Enjoy the beer Saturday night.
Oh, absolutely, bud. There he was, ladies and gentlemen, Josh Gratton. Very, very happy to finally get to talk to Josh. That was an awesome episode. Everyone go check him out on Instagram and all that good shit. Again, love you guys. Hey!